it's a terrific pleasure to be here, and I've given a number of talks about nuclear power, and I've titled my talk really here Chernobyl 25 Years On. In the beginning of this year, because I've given a lot of talks on nuclear power, I was actually wondering, would anyone notice that it was the 25th anniversary of Chernobyl? My word, they have, and they did, because of what happened in Fukushima. So what I'd like to do today is to think a little bit about what happened in Chernobyl, and then compare and contrast to that with what happened in Fukushima, and then see if there are any lessons we can learn about those two accidents, and look forward to consider what is now the future of nuclear power. It is interesting, every time I give a talk on nuclear power, I always get something back from the audience, and today I hope I can get some reflections back on the medical side of things, because I've not actually addressed a specifically medical audience before, so I'm hopeful that we can get some questions. And I also start off my talks with a rather nice picture of a nuclear power plant, if I can find one, and there are some gorgeous pictures of nuclear power plants, and this is one, and I'll point out which one that is shortly, although I'm sure most of you recognise this already. I've outlined what I'm going to talk about here. I'm going to give a little primer, a very brief one on nuclear reactors and how they work, because it's actually germane to what I want to talk about. Obviously talk about Chernobyl, obviously talk about Fukushima, talk about the context that Japan now finds itself in, because it's actually a very, very interesting one, and the world situation and the implications thereof. And if I've got time, if at the end nobody wants to ask any questions, I can talk a little bit further about some of the implications of this. Nuclear power is a significant energy source, and indeed it's a low CO2 source. When you look at the full life cycle costs of nuclear power, it is actually a low CO2 emitting source of energy, and the world today is very, very dependent on energy. How it works, however, in some ways is very, very simple. One has a source of heat, which is a nuclear core here, and then beyond this, it all pretty much looks like a standard power station, whether it's a coal-fired power station or a gas-fired power station. You produce heat, you put it through turbines, those turbines drive generators, and those generators provide our grid with the electrical power that we need. And this is a pretty typical sort of reactor. It's a pressurized water reactor, and a good fraction of the reactors in the world are these pressurized water reactors. And when I was talking about nuclear power plants before this year, I'd put this up as my standard slide to explain how a nuclear power plant works. These days I have to put another slide up, which is this other sort of reactor, which is a boiling water reactor, and really it's very, very similar. The main difference, of course, is that the heat source is the same, but the hot water for this goes straight to the turbines, whereas in this model it goes through a heat exchanger and then to the turbines. But by and large, these two reactors are pretty similar designs. And by and large, the reactors are contained within concrete structures. And this one here is the Fukushima-type reactor with some sort of steel framework top on it, containing the bits of the reactor that you need to get at to service the reactor. A point worth noting is that they're typically about 30% efficient, which is actually quite low if you compare it to, say, combined cycle gas turbines. What that means is that if you have, as in Fukushima number one, a reactor that produces 450 megawatts of electrical power, it actually produces something like 1300, 1400 megawatts of heat. And that's, of course, where the whole thing comes undone, as we'll see shortly. Just to give you a flavour of what one really looks like, here's a mock-up of the Fukushima-type reactor. This is in a train station in Japan. That's where the fuel rods would be, and if you stood this close to one of those reactors, you'd die pretty quickly. A thing worth noting about is the amount of plumbing that goes in here. Most of the plumbing up here is to do the separation of the steam, so the water vapour from the steam, and then that water vapour goes off to drive the turbines, and then all sorts of plumbing that you have in a reactor here to bring the water back into the plant to keep it cooled and so forth. There is another variant of these reactors, and this is the Chernobyl-type reactor, and again, it's worth spending 2 minutes looking at this one. Differs slightly in that it has a water-moderated core, but it's also got graphite in it. And unlike those reactors I showed you to this point, it doesn't have a containment structure around it. It only has the building itself. And again, this was one of the problems that happened in the Chernobyl reactor. So, Chernobyl, 25 years ago, 25th of April, the engineers at the plant were doing a test in the reactor. They disabled all the safety systems. They lowered the reactor down to see and do an experiment to see, could the reactor sustain itself if the power shut down. Now, there's a deja vu for you, isn't it? This is what failed to work properly at Fukushima, but yet that was precisely the incident that people were testing in Chernobyl. They got to a certain point when they realised that they'd actually switched the reactor down to such a point that if it kept on going, they would actually shut it off completely, and reactors have this little feature in that if you shut it down, you actually have to leave it for 3 days before you can start it up again. And that would have been a mistake because it's coming up to the May Day holiday, and that's not what they wanted to do. So they switched it on again, and they switched it on very rapidly, and that caused boiling of the water in the reactor core. And because it had graphite moderating it as well, it has a very different feature from most of the reactors used in the West, that if you lose the water, the reaction rate goes up. And that caused the reaction rate to accelerate very, very quickly, and it blew the top off the building and then started a fire in that graphite core, and that fire burnt for 10 days. So an enormous accident. And this, I think, is one of the most interesting and excellent animations of what happens here. So here's a time slice of the radiation being emitted from the Chernobyl plant. This is days down the bottom. So this is one day in already. And at this point here, the radioactive plume is only just creeping over Scandinavia. And it's not until about now that a reactor site in Sweden observes high radiation levels and thought its reactor was leaking. So not until about 2 or 3 days in that anyone knew out in the outside world or even in the Soviet Union that there was a reactor accident. And this is the timeline running along here. So 1, 2, 3, 4. So after 4 days, the fire is still pumping radioactive material into the atmosphere, and the winds are taking it around all of Europe. So the wind's now to the south here, and in another day or so, the winds will change direction again. Now, this is not a measurement of the plume. This is actually a calculation that was done moderately recently, where people in France took the weather data and then computed the distribution and then got it to map out where the radiation was actually observed. So here you see it coming across the UK and parts of Scotland received some radiation here. It's again streaming down to the south here, and we're only 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 days into this fire burning continuously, pumping radioactive materials high up into the atmosphere, and it's still going. 9 days, it's still going. So this reactor accident is very, very different from what's happened in Fukushima, and we'll show you that in a while. So again, what have we got to? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. About now, you see the source has disappeared. So the plume has vanished, but this radiation is now dispersing in the atmosphere. Quite a dramatic picture. So what was released? Well, lots of radioactive material was released. All of the volatile components in the reactor core were released, and including some fragments of the core itself were released. And the numbers we talk about here in terms of radioactive material talk about becquerels, the disintegration per second, for a measure of the activity. And the prefix here is P, peta, 10 to the 15, significant amounts of radioactive materials released. So what were the consequences of that? Well, there was an extreme event, 10 days, trying to put this fire out, trying to quench the fire. Lots of people then evacuated from the region, so hundreds of thousands of people evacuated and relocated. 600,000 people, all told, involved in the cleanup exercises to do this reactor, and millions of people affected in some way. So what were the medical consequences associated with this? And there was a report in 2005, and this is the outcome of that report. So this report said there were about 50 direct deaths, and these were firemen and workers on the plant who received high doses of radiation. There was a tremendous spike in thyroid cancers, and these were all attributed to the Chernobyl reactor accident. Remember, what happened in that accident is that the public around it were not notified for days that anything had gone wrong, and iodine has a very, very short half-life, gets into the food chain very quickly, so these people were eating vegetables in the garden, milk from the cows, and accumulating the iodine in the thyroid, and that is a cause of thyroid cancer, and a number of deaths associated with this as well. What wasn't observed was leukemia increases. Now, there were obviously leukemia in that region, but when you do the comparison to like regions, you can't see a statistical difference, and neither in birth anomalies and so on. All told, this report puts the potential deaths due to this to something like 4,000. Now, this is hotly contested because, of course, Greenpeace put out a report a year or so later, and they would claim that the actual death toll directly due to this reactor accident is more like 100,000, maybe 100,000 plus. Now, where does this come from? Well, this comes from stuff that you know about quite well. And the reason it is that we don't actually know what is the consequence of low amounts of radioactivity or radioactive exposure to people. We know what happens at high radiation doses. If we give a person something like 7 to 10 sieverts of radiation, then they will die. And that's a fairly clear outcome. And as you go down, it's more or less a linear trend. If you give a person less radiation, there'll be consequences associated with that. And you can go down to around 100 to 200 millisieverts and show a direct causal relationship between some damage and the radiation that the person was exposed to. The question is, what happens lower than that? And again, interestingly, some of the best data we have comes from Japan, and it comes from the bomb tests in Japan. And here's some data from this paper here, 2003 paper, which is looking at some of that Japanese data. And it's not, and what it's plotting here is the estimated excess relative risk associated with radiation dose along the bottom here, and including cohorts where they've identified radiation levels up to 50 millisieverts, up to 100, up to 125, up to 150, up to 200. And it's not until you get to about 125 that you can actually say that there's some statistical correlation between the effect that you see and the radiation that these people were exposed to. So again, there's a vacuum, a dark cloud, an unknown region that we can't do the association between radiation and some biological health effects. So the obvious thing to do, or an obvious thing to do, is to take what we know at very high doses, which is way up here, and do a linear extrapolation down to zero and say that there's no threshold and it just goes on to zero. Again, the evidence is probably saying we can't, it doesn't kick in till about 100 or 200 millisieverts. And then the big question comes, you know, what happens, because all of us are exposed to radiation from a variety of sources of the order of 20 millisieverts per year. And how can you establish, given that there's this continual background, what is the consequence of that? And that's really a difficult question. And there are a number of models. As I say, this one here is a reasonable one, but there are other ones. One is, as people say, there is no safe level of radiation. So the curve has to come down here and, you know, there's no safe level. So there's always some harm at some point, even if the radiation levels are very low. I don't think you can argue it can't go to zero at some point. It has to go to zero at some point. No radiation, no health effect. That has to be a point on your curve. But how it gets to that point, not at all clear. There is, of course, another school of thought that says there's a threshold dose below which there are no health consequences, or none that we can measure. And even another school of thought that says actually a little bit of radiation is good for you. And there's people that pursue that line as well. So we don't know, and of course, living in a background of 20 millisieverts per year, it's going to be very, very difficult for anyone to do an experiment that can actually tell us what happens in that region there. And one of the you know, silver linings in the Fukushima cloud, interestingly, may be to give us a cohort of people that actually, a large cohort of people, that are actually exposed to low levels of radiation, and if we track them for 60 and 70 years, we may learn something out of this. So, of course, there's some, you know, this is where the Greenpeace argument comes in. If you're following a strict linear no threshold model, the argument goes something like this, that if 10 sieverts will kill you, then 10 millisieverts exposed to 1,000 people will cause one death. Or another way, 10 microsieverts to 1 million people will cause one death. And that's an argument that comes out of the linear no threshold hypotheses. And as we saw in the Chernobyl situation, a lot of radiation was distributed around all of Europe. And millions of people were affected. So therefore, on this model here, you'll get deaths as a consequence of that. But of course, these are statistical deaths, and you don't know, stochastics says you don't know when it's going to occur. It might occur when the person's 60, 70, 80, you don't actually know. But that's, therein is where the argument is. And here are some plots of the radiation currently, or a few years ago, around Europe here, and some reasonably high levels of radiation around here, but some hot spots in Scandinavia still, some hot spots in Europe where the rain brought down the radiation, some hot spots down here in Greece as well. So here's a zoom in of the region around the Chernobyl plant here, and there are some regions here with very high radiation, and people still live. These are not exclusion zones. There's a 20-kilometre exclusion zone that's about a bit bigger than that little spot there around the Chernobyl plant there, but lots of people live in areas where the radiation is high, and I'll come back to this picture later with regards to Fukushima. So what's happening in Chernobyl now is, this is a picture of the sarcophagus. It needs replacing. It got built in a hurry. It needs replacing with a more sturdy structure that will last for hundreds of years. What were the lessons learned out of Chernobyl? Did we actually learn them? Well, I think the answer is going to be no here. The first one is that communication is absolutely vital. You have to be able to communicate with people in your region absolutely transparently, because the second point, it'll all come out, and that's not some pun on the radiation. That's when the forensic analysis of what happens in the accident, you will not be able to say, oh, well, we didn't know then, or it'll come out that you did not tell the people when you did know. And that will reflect badly on the operator. It reflected very badly on the processes in the Soviet Union at that time, and it's reflecting very badly on the operators of the plant and the government in Japan at the moment. Another little rider is here, is you don't let people do things that they're not meant to do. People actually knew that if you operate this sort of reactor in the mode that the operators were operating it, it will blow up. The designers of the plant knew this. They didn't tell the operators. They didn't tell the operators that communication is vital. So, to Japan. So this is the situation of nuclear power plants in Japan. Japan is reliant on nuclear power, 30% of its electricity, 15% of its energy, but 30% of its electricity is generated by nuclear power, distributed all around the country in almost all locations. And we have a number of plants sitting near to where this earthquake was. Interestingly, a couple of years ago, there was another earthquake, and the epicenter of that earthquake was right there. I can't even get it right. Right on top of that other power plant, also owned by TEPCO. And it was a more minor earthquake, 6 or 7 on the Richter scale, knocked out the plant for a couple of years and cost TEPCO billions of dollars in substituted oil and coal that they had to buy to generate the electricity. So where did this earthquake come from? This earthquake comes from the place of all earthquakes, sliding plates, and there's a number of plates intersecting in this region here. There's a plate going this way, there's a plate going this way, and the release of stress on these plates here, the movement of this plate here, caused a significant earthquake. And it relieves the strain here, but it does beg the question that it's increased the strain up here, and it's increased the strain down here, so there will be another big earthquake in Japan, and the question is when. So this was March the 11th, in the middle of the afternoon. There was an earthquake and a tsunami, and if I can bear with me, I'll just show you this video, which I think is one of the most dramatic pictures of the tsunami. And this is one of the bays nearby where the tsunami is coming. This is a seawall here, and the tsunami is just swelling up over the seawall. And I'll just wait a few more frames longer. I'm sure you've all seen these videos, but this is just dramatic stuff. And you get this evil black wall of water coming in. And for those that are fans of Japanese anime movies, that's how they show it. It's really quite eerie and interesting. And the force of that water is extraordinary. So this is what happened as a consequence. And actually, to some extent, what we're looking at with Chernobyl has overshadowed what was a much greater disaster with the tsunami inundating large parts of the coastline in Japan. So I'll move on from that because I want to talk about the nuclear thing and leave some time for questions. So you could have guessed what my nuclear power plant was. This is the Fukushima Daiichi plant, and it's got 6 reactors here. So all told, what's that? 2 and a bit gigawatts, about 10% of the power that Australia would need in a day is generated on this one site here. It built the first one here, which is a moderately sized one, 400 odd megawatts. Built another one here back in the 70s of 760. It was a good design, so they replicated it. They replicated a fifth one the same size, and then they built a more recent one here and built them bigger. And that's indeed the trend with nuclear power plants. You're building them bigger and bigger to make them more efficient all the time. And here are some pictures which I think are very dramatic as well. This is the tsunami. So if we go back to this one, this is the generator buildings here. These are the reactor buildings here themselves. And this is a picture, This is a picture of the tsunami striking the edge of the wall there. And that's the height of the reactor building there. So the plume of that wave goes higher than that. Quite a striking photo, that one. And of course, here's a couple of images of the sea coming in here, and then a few seconds later it's just flooding the whole region there. There's another one, because I'm a physicist, I like pictures of waves. This is another interesting photo of wave. This is actually after the tsunami, and it's the backwash of the waves from the breakwater here. Again, how people have caught these images is quite staggering, but staggering images nonetheless. So what's the problem here? The problem here is it exposed some weaknesses, and the weaknesses it exposed that there were paths of the water into this building here through trenches and so on that flooded the turbine halls. Now, why does that matter? It matters because the backup generators for this nuclear reactor were situated down here in a place which is nice and safe, not up here, because if you put it up here, it's susceptible to movement in the earthquakes and more vulnerable. So the argument was, let's put it down here where it's safe. But of course, because they had paths for entry of the water into the system, these generators flooded. Now, what does that mean? Well, we have to look and think about what a new nuclear reactor looks like to see what that means. Here's a blown-up view of the nuclear reactor. Here we have the nuclear core here, and normally what happens is this produces heat. The steam goes off to drive the turbines, and then they come back, and you have a pressure vessel here, and then you keep it inside a containment vessel that stops stuff getting out. But this is a high-pressure vessel here, runs at 3 or 4 atmospheres pressure. So what happened in this reactor here? Well, what happened just after the earthquake was perfect. Everything went normally. This was a severe earthquake, the biggest, bigger in fact, by 3 or 4 times what the plant was designed for, and it worked perfectly. It started the shutdown process, the scram process, which shut down the nuclear reactor, isolated this building here, and started the shutdown processes in a normal way. And that all worked perfectly, even though, as I say, the quake that this plant got exposed to was 3 or 4 or 5 times bigger than the design. It all worked perfectly. Now, if it's shut down, what's the problem? Well, the problem is that even after you switch off a nuclear reactor, there's still a lot of heat produced. In fact, it's not a lot of heat, it's only 6% of the generating heat. But when you're talking about 1,500 megawatts of heat, 6% of 1,500 megawatts of heat is still a number in the megawatts. It's still a lot of heat. And this is a logarithmic curve, it's log on time here. So this is a fraction of a day, a hundredth of a day, and it's not until about a day that it gets to below about 10 megawatts of heat in this reactor here. So a lot of heat that you have to get rid of. Now, the system is designed for this. So when you shut down a nuclear reactor and isolate it in the way, it is designed to work continually cooling it down. And the way it does that is that the steam from the reactor drives a turbine here, and that turbine continues to drive the pumps. So even though it's got no external power, the reactor core here is still being cooled. The problem that you have is that if you isolate this plant, so if you remove all of the power from the system, your generator goes, there is no net heat loss from the system. So even though you use the reservoirs that are down here, if you don't start taking away that heat, at some point the system gets hotter and hotter. And if the system gets hotter and hotter, it boils more and more of the water. So you transfer the water into steam. So you produce more and more water, and these fuel rods then become exposed and they get hot. And a fuel rod is something about the size of my finger. It's got uranium oxide with a zirconium alloy cladding on it. And if you heat it up to about 700-800 degrees, this cladding starts to blister and lets out some of the volatile radioactive materials inside this fuel rod. So you have the situation that some of the volatile materials get released into this wet well space, but it's still within the containment vessel, so that shouldn't cause you any grief because it's still contained within in the structure here. Now, as time goes on, so this is, you know, now just after midnight, remember the earthquake happened 2 o'clock in the afternoon. So just after midnight, the pressure is still rising in this here, and the core is starting to melt. Now, once you get these fuel rods up to something like 1400 degrees, an interesting reaction occurs if you've got any water there, is that the zirconium cladding starts reacting with the water to produce hydrogen. So there's a reaction that occurs on the cladding that produces hydrogen gas, and the solution to this is that you vent it, and it's designed to do this, you vent it out into this interspace up here. And you filter this, if you can, so you keep the radioactive materials back, but you vent the hydrogen because you don't want this thing here getting to such a point that it ruptures that pressure vessel. It's got a deliberate venting to occur. But of course, the consequence of that is that at some point you have a large amount of hydrogen gas there, and again, you've seen these images before, but it is worth seeing it yet again. You have almost the worst thing that could ever happen at a nuclear reactor, and that's an explosion. And this is not a nuclear explosion, it's a hydrogen gas explosion blowing the top of the roof off this building here. Okay, so there's another sequence of those images there. Now, when this happened, nobody was telling anyone what was going on. And again, I said one of the lessons of Chernobyl was that communication is vitally important, but finding good information about what was happening here was very, very difficult. And it wasn't until May the 16th that people were actually admitting, well, yes, indeed, the reactor core had melted down. And in fact, almost all the fuel rods were molten by 7 o'clock that next morning. So even before the hydrogen explosion, they were dealing with a meltdown situation. And it was worse than that, is that also the pressure vessel here was leaking, and also the containment vessel of this reactor was leaking as well. And we didn't know this until about the middle of May either. And what that leaves is a lot of radioactive water in the bottom of this concrete structure here. And this water, and water on the site, has been the problem that the people in this plant have had to deal with for months and months afterward, and it's still the major problem they have to deal with here. So this is the first reactor. Now, meltdowns have happened before, and meltdowns stopped the nuclear build in the United States with this reactor. This is the Three Mile Island reactor in March, and this is kind of interesting. You know, if you look at when reactor accidents occur, they occur in March and April in the Northern Hemisphere, so don't go travelling to nuclear power plants in March and April. It's not good for you. So what happened there is a similar sort of thing. They lost coolant to this reactor while it was operating, and it melted down. And again, 3 days of a very anxious period, no hydrogen gas explosion, and two-thirds of the core melted and slumped into the bottom here. This is what this yellow is here. And no breach of the containment, and now this reactor has been fully decommissioned and all of this material has been removed. But this is now 79 here, so a good number of years later, but that's what's happened in this reactor. So I talked about reactor number one, but actually unit number three was a carbon copy of that. So this is March the 12th, that's when the first reactor exploded. People realised that they had to vent this one as well because the pressure was building up in the structure here. They're also trying to inject seawater into this reactor to keep it cool, and they had to continually pump tons and tons and tons of water into these reactors to keep them cool. And getting rid of that water is causing the headache now. And again, in the middle of the morning, on the Monday morning, so the first one exploded on the Saturday, this is on the Monday morning, this reactor blew up in exactly the same way. And if the first reactor accident explosion wasn't dramatic, this one here was even more so. Very, very scary stuff, actually. So what about unit number two? Well, that also had an explosion. The structure, the building structure itself, remained intact, but the same sort of cycle, had to vent it, and there was an explosion. But people believe, because we don't actually know yet where that explosion is, that that was an explosion that ruptured the containment wall inside the suppression pool here. So it didn't blow the top of the building off, but did some damage internally. And again, leakage out here. And again, although people don't know, it's probable that all of those reactor cores are melted, all of them. So here's a picture taken on March the 15th, so this will be on the Tuesday, of the reactor site. And it was, again, very hard to get good images from this. This is unit number one, blew the roof off quite cleanly. And if it hadn't been for leaks in the pressure vessel and the containment structure, one could argue, well, that's survived pretty nicely. But if you look down the stack, there's number two. At this point, an explosion had already occurred in number two, but the building was intact. Look further down, this is number three, and this is looking to number four. I have another picture here. Here's number three, so that was that significant, massive explosion here. And of course, look across to this one here, which is number four, which I haven't talked about. And this is really interesting. So what happened in unit number four? And again, this is the one that actually caused me and a lot of people the most anxiety. Because at the time, this reactor was not operating at all. This reactor was off, and the nuclear fuel was stored in this fuel pond here. And people were taking measurements of the temperature of this fuel pond here. Again, they had no pumps to top up the water here, and the temperature was rising. And if you rise it and it boils off, the anxiety here was that the fuel rods there were exposed and melting down. And unlike the other reactors, the inventory in this pool was about three times that of what is in the reactor itself. And there is no containment structure at all around this. And this would be a very, very, very serious event. And people got very worried. And if you want to see some of the most, you know, desperation videos I've ever seen, and this is water bombing of by helicopter of that number four unit to try and put some water back into that fuel pond, which didn't work at all. In the end, people used fire hoses, and eventually I'll show, I think I've got a picture of a snorkel that does it. So what's the story here? Well, now people believe, because they took this photo in April, and this is a photo of the fuel pond itself, and it doesn't look like it's melted down. It doesn't look like it's been destroyed. And now people believe, actually, that the unit explosion in unit number four was because of hydrogen gas leaking across from number three through this common pipework structure here into number four and the explosion occurring there. Now, we don't know whether that's the case, and it's going to be a long time before people actually find out whether that's true or not. But the potential for having a fire in a nuclear fuel pond was a pretty scary scenario. And here's some more recent images after that point. So this is a picture now of the snorkel that is still there, topping up the fuel in number four, and this is the picture of number three. And these were taken by a flying little drone aircraft over, aircraft that size, over this plant and taking the images. So by any measure, a serious accident, and you know, there were initial talks about it being, you know, a category three accident, but very quickly people realized, because of the amount of radiation emitted, if nothing else, but also because of the fact you've got accidents at three different reactors at one site, albeit, and even a fourth, it is absolutely a major accident. Only about a tenth of the emissions from Chernobyl, and that's a very, very important point. And here's the strategy, very, very complicated strategy for trying to fix it. This was released in April, 17th of April, so the designs were there to try and mitigate all of this. And the frustrating thing is that an integral part of this is to use the water that's already here for the cooling of it. And that requires you to filter that water, remove the radioactive materials, rather than just keep adding water to the system, because you've got to put it somewhere. And that's what they struggle to do, is to find a place to put what is now quite radioactive water. What you have to do is be able to take it, filter it, and have it in a closed system here, and they are still struggling to do this. What about the information flow? Here's, I think, a fascinating curve, and I like to celebrate these people because these people are on the ball. The data is streamed from a whole lot of measuring sites here, which is streamed as part of the monitoring processes, nuclear reactors. These people in Germany, which is responsible for the reactor safety agency in Germany, started plotting it at about here. And they made this available on the web. And then as the time went on, they just kept plotting it. And this was excellent. So these guys get my first prize for information dissemination. This is how you should do it. But it is interesting that a German site was providing this and not anything from Japan, and not even the IAEA either. And as I say, it was very, very difficult to get good quality information, and this was by far and away the best site doing it. So since then, people have been measuring the radioactive fallout from, the consequence of that. By and large, the emissions from this plant were only transitory, as is indicated, and this really huge spikes associated largely with the explosions, and so on, and then sort of the decay away. Occasional leaks of radioactive water, but that's not going to cause you too much grief because most of it will go into the sea and high dilution factors there. The radioactive plumes that get released, where they go depends on the winds, as we saw in the Chernobyl situation here. And here's an image done by a US DOE and the Japanese Nuclear Safety Agency, aerial survey flying over all of this, mapping where the radiation was. This is two of the cesium isotopes. And you see this big plume here. You hear this village mentioned a lot. This is outside the 20-kilometer, that's this one here, exclusion zone. But because of the winds, it picks up high radioactivity in that area there. There was Mike Willisey gave a radio report this morning talking about this village here. I would have no problems going to that village there now. Not a problem. It is really interesting to compare this picture with the Chernobyl picture. And that's what I've done here. So what I've done is to take these two images and put them on the same physical scale, and although I have little control over this scale here, they're pretty close, they're not identical in terms of the colours as well. And this is Fukushima, and this is the zoomed in region around the Chernobyl factory, Chernobyl reactor here. And the scale here I think is evident. And this is not only measuring the amount of radioactivity that's distributed over all of Europe, this is just the local contamination. And again, people are living in these red regions here now in the former Soviet Union, so in Ukraine and Belarus and Russia itself. So very interesting contrast, I think, here with the scale of Fukushima and this one. And again, the sorts of radioactive materials here, lots of core fragments as well, hardly anything, tiny, I mean one or two reports of plutonium released, which can actually be confused with plutonium that comes from bomb tests. So I've got another 5 or 10 minutes. Yep. I just want to talk about the implications of this and where nuclear power is going. To do it, I want to talk specifically about Japan and then talk about the world more generally. Japan's a really interesting place for power. There are about 10 major power operators. TEPCO is by far and away one of the bigger ones, supplies the Tokyo region. It's interesting in that it's got two frequencies. So you go to one half of the country, it works on 60 hertz. You go on the other half of the country, it goes on 50 hertz. And there's only two links across that, and those two links can only ship a gigawatt of power. Now, Japan in a day can use up to, more than that in fact, up to 180, 190, 200 gigawatts of power. In Australia, we use about 24, 25 gigawatts per day. Japan, you know, as I say, these are the records up to 2004. There was a higher one in 2004, but that was the highest to date. 182 gigawatts, and it occurs in the middle of the afternoon, and it occurs, so this is day, so 2 a.m. Midnight, and it occurs in summer. So this is month, so this is August here, sorry, August there. The spikes occur because of air conditioning. The heating is not so much of a problem. This is the winter spike. This is the air conditioning that Japan requires to keep people happy and comfortable. So in Japan, as I mentioned, 30% of the electricity comes from nuclear power plants. And it made that decision a long time ago because it has no oil reserves, coal reserves of its own. It almost has no choice but to go to nuclear. And it is interesting to think about Japan, you know, the country that was bombed with atomic weapons, adopting nuclear power in the first place. And it was made as a hard decision because it had little other choice. And it had 51 different reactors, and it generates, as I say, about 44 gigawatts electrical nearly all the time. So the operating efficiency is about 70% for all of these reactors here. And that meets 30% of Japanese electrical needs. So an interesting thing happened in May is that the Japanese government asked this plant to shut down. So the plants that were shut down, of course, was the Fukushima plant 1 and 2, so Daiichi and Daini, and also some of the other plants on this coastline here. But there's another plant here, which is the Hamamoka plant, which is this one, which is a long way away, and yet the Japanese government asked the operator of this plant, which is not TEPCO, to shut this one down too. And they asked them to shut it down because they deemed this one to be vulnerable, just like the Fukushima plant sits on a nice beach, and we know that there's going to be another big earthquake. right? The consequence of the big earthquake, it means you know there's going to be one to the north and one to the south. This is to the south, sitting where that fault line is here, and there is going to be one here. And they asked to shut down this one here. And what's remarkable out here, this reactor here is one of Japan's newest reactors. So you can't even argue that it's old. This is one of the newest reactors, one of these advanced boiling water reactors, full of all the modern safety systems. And yet the Japanese government asked Hamamoko to shut down. And they're talking about building a 15-meter seawall to just prevent any similar occurrence. Not only that, these plants normally cycle on and off. There has not been a cycling on of any nuclear power plant in Japan since the accident. And what that means is that there's only now 11 nuclear reactors running in Japan. And out of service, as I say, is two-thirds of all of the electrical power generation by nuclear in Japan. An extraordinary loss of capacity. In fact, this is the curves I showed before. This is plotting what was actually achieved over the summer. So the cuts in Japan have actually been remarkable. They've actually managed to cut their usage to this point here. So even though the summers peak up here, they've actually managed to hold it to that point, which is actually quite remarkable. And they're worried now, because the winter one is going up, whether they can actually meet that too. Now, I said when I was first talking about this, I said that if Japan can get through its summer without major blackouts, Japan will probably walk away from nuclear power. It's actually done that. It's now past this critical point here. It's going to be really interesting if they can go a whole year without that nuclear capability. The chance of those plants getting switched on again goes down and down and down if Japan can do it over a cycle. Well, what about the whole world? Here are all the nuclear power stations in the world. Japan features bigger, or big here. Soviet Union or former Soviet Union countries, the US, of course, Canada, and Europe. Few random ones distributed around the world. If you want to find out where they are, of course, you can just get an app on your iPhone. So when you're traveling, you can be really sure that you have got good, reliable electricity, or you can avoid it depending on your particular perspective. And here's a distribution of the fraction that a country relies on with electrical power, and I'll show another graph in a minute or two. Lithuania used to get almost 100% of its electricity. That's going and it goes up to 80, so I'm cheating here, until 2009, and it shut down its one reactor. So it's off the radar. It was actually one of the Chernobyl-type reactors, interestingly, shut down in 2009. So the biggest next one is France, and where's Japan's here, so 30-odd% of electricity generated in Japan. Germany is another one I'm going to talk about. And, of course, China and India down here only generate 5% or so of electricity with nuclear. This tells part of the story. What's going to happen in the future? Well, you know, if you talk to somebody like Barry Brook, who gave a talk at the ANU last week, he'd show you this picture. You know, we're sitting somewhere here, advanced boiling water reactor types, generation 3, lots of new designs for nuclear reactors on the drawing boards. Is it going to happen or not? Very important question. And these designs promise passive safety features, all the things we didn't have at Fukushima. You know, water supply at the top, so if the power goes off, it flows by gravity, and then evaporative cooling keeps the whole thing cool. So the story goes. And this is an interesting curve, and I haven't plotted in last year's, but that's sort of up here somewhere, over 15, most of them in China, actually. So it was accelerating rapidly, a new nuclear build. After this hiatus, after Three Mile Island, a lot of things in the pipeline, and then after Chernobyl, nuclear physics was really, or nuclear power, bad slip there, Nick. Nuclear power was going absolutely nowhere until people realised, quite rightly, it is a low CO2 generator of electricity and can generate it in large quantities all of the time. So what about other countries in the world? Here's an interesting example here. This is a reactor I'm actually very fond of, the Mühlenkirch reactor. I saw it running because I lived in Germany. I went to Germany in 2006, so just after Chernobyl, and I did see this reactor running. It actually got shut down in 1987, ran for about 5 or 6 months, and then the anxiety in Germany after Chernobyl shut it down. So the Germans do make decisions, and they shut down a brand new nuclear reactor. And one of the reasons they did it is that they, the people against it, said that you haven't done the earthquake report properly. Now, those of you that know Germany knows that the Rhine Valley is not particularly susceptible to earthquakes, but an argument was put and won that they hadn't done that survey correctly and the plant was shut down. A couple of billion dollars worth of infrastructure built by Siemens, shut down. And then, of course, in Germany, a lot of very interesting things happened just after Chernobyl. This is after Angela Merkel announced that the way Germany was going to deal with things for its power generation was to increase the lifetime of nuclear plants. And, of course, just after Fukushima, there was an election in one of the states in Germany, and that was seen as a very negative endorsement of that policy. And then the CDU, Angela Merkel's party, proposed an accelerated withdrawal from nuclear power by 2020. And Germany, even a country as technologically advanced and as committed to renewables, is really going to struggle to meet that target. And as I say, we heard just last Monday that Siemens, who built most of the reactors in Germany, are going to withdraw from the nuclear power plant game. So other things happen as well. Switzerland says it's going to withdraw in 2034. That's when they were scheduled to shut down their existing couple of plants and won't continue with nuclear after that. So here's the graph I showed before. The landscape's changing very quickly. Germany, a few years' time, will not have nuclear. Japan, even if it started up the other reactors, is going to lose Fukushima here. Switzerland's going to go. But, of course, this is a distorted picture. This shows the fraction in the country. What this graph shows is, in absolute terms, how much electricity comes from the nuclear stations. And this is a very different curve. This puts the US at the top. So the US generates most of the nuclear electricity. And there has not been a new nuclear power station built in the US since Three Mile Island. Right? So there is no way, after Fukushima, that another nuclear power plant, I think, is going to be built in the US. The public will not stand for it. France is the biggie still. Japan is here, and again, there's real doubts whether Japan is going to go along the nuclear route. And if you take out the big three, that's going to be really a very different nuclear landscape. So ones to look at here, however, this is India. Remember, India on the other graph was down here somewhere at 5%. And the other one that we have to find here is China. Okay, so even though, as a fraction of the power generation they have, they're tiny, in absolute numbers, they're getting more significant. And this is actually my prediction, and indeed it's been reinforced by a meeting that was held last week at the IAEA, where India is still indicating that the nuclear route is the route they're going to follow. So what's going to happen over the next few years is that India's absolute component is going to increase, and China's absolute component's going to increase, but the US one will go down. It'll probably go down fairly quickly as these old plants get taken out. Japan, who knows? You could argue, even though they'll find it very, very difficult, particularly the way their economy is, who knows? And this interesting thing in France, this survey in France, that 55% of French people are against abandoning nuclear energy. Only 55%. I mean, it's a funny double negative here. It's not 55% for nuclear power. They're against abandoning it. And that is actually quite a significant mood swing in a place like France. And this shows one of the bigger reactor plants in France. And as you can see here, very clearly, they don't think tsunamis are going to worry them in the English Channel here because of where that's situated. So what I want to talk about is what does that mean? What are the lessons that we've learnt from Fukushima? And one of the things is that there are obvious contingencies that people miss. People should have thought that the tsunami record said that you are going to get a tsunami bigger than what you planned for. They should have predicted that. Right? So that was an obvious contingency missed. They also missed some 2020 hindsight, some obvious failure modes at this nuclear plant. And one is, what happens if your generators get flooded? What happens if all the generators on all your plants get flooded at the same time? They didn't think about that. That's an obvious, in hindsight, obvious failure mode of a plant like that. There was no backup for generators, although, you can argue that things were pretty tough. The whole countryside in that region got hit with a tsunami that killed tens of thousands of people. You know, it's difficult to get a truck and build it, bring in a new generator. But they missed that contingency. And then, you know, what happens if your power is gone for an extended duration? What can you do to mitigate those circumstances? Now, in hindsight, they are obvious contingencies, but in, you know, when you build a nuclear power plant, you are challenged to think of all contingencies. And the nuclear industry says, we know what we're doing, we've thought about this, trust us. This says that you've lost that argument. And that means that in many countries in the world, getting that trust back is going to be one of the big challenges. One of the other things that I think, but again, people obviously probably knew more than I did, but the data we were seeing from TEPCO really didn't tell us what was going on at all. So the lack of diagnostics, the fact that we had to wait months till we knew the cores were melting down, says that there's obvious lack of diagnostic instrumentation in the reactors. So again, it's easy for me standing over here to criticise that, and maybe they knew more than they were saying, but if they knew more than they were saying, they've failed the first lesson of the Chernobyl accident, which communication is vital. Another couple of ones that come up too is the proximity of reactors. You know, reactor number 4 may have had an explosion because it was next to reactor number 3. Now, one of the ways nuclear power is economic is that when you get licensing for a site, you plant a whole lot of different reactors side by side. If, as a consequence of this one, they'll have to be separated by a proper exclusion zone, that's going to make it much, much harder to build nuclear power plants in the future. And then this other one here, people are criticising the fit-out of these reactors and that these are reactors built in the 70s, yet the approach of the world has been, these reactors have been working really well for the last 40 years, let's extend them for another 20 years. I think that's an argument that's not going to be acceptable either. And I'll stop with this picture but take questions. Thanks very much.
Thanks very much, Aidan. I'm sure there'll be some questions. A question here.
Aidan.
Yeah.
In the case of France, we know that the French nuclear tests in the Pacific, seems that they want to test their nuclear capability far away from the continent of Europe. Have there been other comparative studies like that done about, you know, the broader picture of nuclear capability, nuclear power and
Well, I mean, there's a whole lot of issues there. So yes. The question here is linking nuclear testing with nuclear power. In some ways, they're coupled and in some ways, they're not. And if you look at countries like England, so the UK, the Soviet Union, and even to some degree the US, the reason they got into nuclear power was a consequence of an arms race and the desire to build and construct nuclear weapons. In France, the argument is slightly different, even though they went down that weapons route fairly quickly. In France, France is another country like Japan that is actually short of oil and gas, and the expansion of nuclear in France was a consequence of the oil shock and not a spillover of taking weapons technology and adapting it to civilian use. So you know, a country like France, I think you should decouple the weapons argument from the need for power. And it's easy to confuse them because it's the same sort of thing, but in many ways it's not at all the same. And what drives a country like Japan to go down a nuclear route, even though it was the victim of atomic warfare, was a desperation in that they don't have other resources that can generate electricity at the need that they have. So I think one does have to separate out those two things, even though the history of it, and that in many ways confuses nuclear power as an energy source in people's mind, because the genesis, quite rightly, was from nuclear weapons and the desire to build and build instruments that produce plutonium for nuclear weapons. That was the origin of reactors in the first place. If it had come out of a different mechanism, so if, for example, the history of nuclear power was similar to perhaps a future history for fusion power, which it comes out of a need to generate electricity without the weapons, it could have been a very interesting story in how we perceive nuclear power and nuclear technologies. So as I say, if nuclear power come out of a desire to solve the CO2 emission problem from coal, and we've got to the point that we are now without the legacy of weapons, we might look at nuclear power and even this accident in a very different light. And we can't do that because we have that history to live with. But I actually think it would be a different thing we would do. Many people, particularly people our age, have the association with nuclear disarmament and so on, have that legacy of a Cold War terror associated with things and find it very hard to decouple. If you talk to the younger generation, they don't have that and they have a different perspective. It is interesting, I have a student who is thinking about the psychological aspect of nuclear, and it is interesting to think about older people's perspectives and younger people's perspectives. And it's been 25 years since Chernobyl, so you talk to a young person, they don't even have that legacy. I mean, I was in Europe, you know, months after Chernobyl and spent 2.5 years there. You know, that was a palpable experience. People in Japan have a real experience now. And of course, the stress, I think, is not going to be from the radioactive materials. It's going to be from the anxiety and the dislocation that gets associated with moving people from their homes. And I think that message is coming out loud and clear from Japan at the moment and was a serious contributor to illness and so on in the Soviet Union. Sorry.
I guess the rational approach to these sorts of decisions would be comparing the risks and benefits of the options.
Yes.
So in China at the moment, their current mechanisms of generating energy aren't particularly safe, either for themselves, for their environment, certainly. And so I guess if you look at Fukushima, the deaths from the primary, the tsunami and earthquake itself, and it's likely that the numbers that will die from the nuclear part of the accident would be
insignificant. Tiny fraction of that.
But the other really important thing is that if as you say, the main problem is public perception, it's extraordinary that institutions will lie and conceal repeatedly. 3 Mile Island.
I don't actually think much was concealed in 3 Mile Island.
Immediately, or was it? Did it take a while to come out?
I think it came out fairly quickly.
Well,
3 Mile Island was an interesting one because a lot of people were evacuated from near the plant. There was a lot of anxiety for about 3 days. There was fear of a hydrogen gas explosion. Didn't actually eventuate. I think that was actually managed reasonably well.
Okay, so Chernobyl, everyone expected would be, we wouldn't be informed properly, we weren't.
As we were.
But with Fukushima, perhaps we would expect to be told more quickly.
Well, indeed, and one has to reflect on maybe the society and the way Japanese society works is different from our society, certainly different from the US society, and the owning up and admitting error is a different cultural thing. I think the Japanese, and I was having a conversation earlier today, were reluctant to bring in outside people for the Kobe earthquake that happened a few years ago. And people are arguing that, you know, the bad response to that was that they didn't bring in help as fast as they should, because culturally it's a society that is not overly ready to bring in external help. I mean, they have a tradition for standing on their own, based on long experience perhaps. And again, one could argue they were very slow at bringing in external help in this situation here too. And, you know, you can argue about why that is. Some of it, certainly, I think, is in the way the society as a whole operates.
Question up there?
Yeah, yeah. Just actually a corollary to that statement. I just wondered, when I observed the media, the whole scenario was that, I mean, to what extent could the situation have been ameliorated if the Japanese had had a truly international response and there had been early and rapid and universal communication at the earliest possible stage? You know, I mean, my impression is, in fact, that it may not have actually made all that much difference, but I mean, could you enlighten us about that?
Yeah, well, I think that's a very good question, and I was thinking about that the other day. You know, would we do it better? You know, if we had a major fire here in Canberra, would we inform the public any better than the Japanese did?
Well, it's not so much the public, but the experts. You know, if all the US nuclear physicists and relevant health professionals had all been notified and there'd been a big international task force, you know, assembled very quickly, would that have made any difference?
Look, I think it could have. It could have. But if you look at the timelines here, the accident happened. It was not even a day later that the first reactor had melted down, and probably, possibly, breaching the pressure vessel and the containment vessel. So in some ways, that
made that one reactor, so the number one unit, a no-go zone immediately. Now, what they could have done was to get feedback with people outside of their area that could have given them commentary to say, well, come on, people, the next one's going to blow up in exactly the same way, and the next one's going to blow up in exactly the same way. And if they got that information and listened to it, they might have prevented the explosions in 2 and 3 and then 4. Now, the question is, you know, realistically, was that likely to happen? The people that know best are probably the people on site, because they have all the information. Did they have enough information, and this was my comment on my slide previously, did they really have enough diagnostics in the reactor to tell them what the real state was? I don't think they did, because the measurements that you got, and they were broadcast, because this stuff is broadcast, just didn't tell you enough about what was going on. So, you know, you broadcast that to the world, you'll get an infinite number of solutions back. How you sift them out, I don't know. A smart thing to do, I think, though, would have been to get some people in there faster to give a more dispassionate commentary and advice, and then have the people on site make their decision. But as I say, the first one blew up within not, well, just over 24 hours, but with 24 hours, basically. And then there was sort of serial explosions, and there were people doing their best in extraordinary circumstances to keep this contained. And it's very easy for me standing here in Canberra to say, well, they could have done a better job. But the whole infrastructure on that bit of the coast, as you saw from that tsunami, was gone. And it's a bit unfair for us to say, actually, they could have done a better job. Could they have got material in there to fix it? Could they have got a generator and connected up faster? Well, they might, but I suspect they were trying their hardest in extraordinarily difficult circumstances. So it's probably, you know, and that will be the interesting thing to have a look at, you know, when the forensic examination of this accident occurs, you know, could we have actually done it better? The Three Mile Island one was a human error. Somebody left a valve closed. The Chernobyl accident was definitely operator error, doing things they should not have been able to do. This one here, I'm not sure yet whether a lot of people can get blamed for a specific individual error that people made, actually. I think they probably followed the book on this one, and they got overwhelmed by an unanticipated scenario, and one, as I said, in 2020 hindsight, they should have had a contingency plan for, and they didn't.
That
leads on to what I was looking at in terms of contingency. I mean, the politics and the economics of contingency are quite difficult, aren't they? And you talk about, you know, how prepared do you have to be for any disaster that's totally imaginable, whether it's going to be a nuclear power plant or the Exxon Valdez, yes, or, you know, something that's happened off the coast of Newcastle, or Fishwick, you know, last week. I mean, you can, on the one hand, you can think about a million scenarios that you can plan for. On the other hand, you can say, well, we can't manage all those because it's too expensive and it makes it economically non-viable to run the project if we have to do all these contingency planning episodes in there. Where do you draw the line, and what are the politics of contingency?
That's right. Exactly. And one way of measuring that is when you have accidents, to see what the rate of that accident and what you've learned from the accident. You know, arguably here, the loss of all of the generators on one of the site,
should have been something that they ought to have planned for. Now, so what you want to do is to have a look and see what their contingency was from a tsunami, because, you know, that region of the coast has been hit by tsunamis before. They should have anticipated that one at least. You know, it's not good enough to say, oh, well, they have other on-site generators, which they did. You know, they had all of those. If they all go out, they should have thought about that one at least. And the problem is the consequences of getting wrong are quite dramatic. I mean, that site will be a difficult site to manage for the next 10 or 20 years. Forces an evacuation of a significant number of people from a radius of 20 kilometres. Now, you could probably get away with that in that region of Japan. You can't with a nuclear reactor closer to a major urban centre like you have in Europe. And it's, you know, the nuclear industry says that they've done all this planning and it's safe. Right. And as I say, they failed in this circumstance here. So do you believe them the next time?
Would you believe in their own nuclear reactor?
Well, I have. I have. And you know, I have no problems with it.
Would you now?
Frank, and then last question from Julia.
In the 50s, the Americans went down two lines, it seems, in terms of their design with the liquid fuel and the
no, really.
Well, they were going. They could have, but they chose not to. And I'm interested. I've heard proponents for the liquid fuel say these reactors are inherently safer.
Yes,
but
right.
I'd be interested in your opinion.
No, I mean, so you can have a liquid sodium reactor, which is inherently safer because it doesn't have this problem with the water coolant and all those sorts of things. One of the reasons that I think they went down the particular path, the Americans in particular, which is the pressurized water reactor, is that they took a design which was a compact, safe design, which was a nuclear submarine design, again, a connection to weapons in some ways, but a nuclear submarine design, and scaled it up, and it worked quite well. So you don't have to do any more technological innovation. You've got something that, you know, is pretty safe and should work. Now, of course, the Three Mile Island accident was a pressurized water reactor, and it failed because somebody had left a valve closed, but that was a different scenario, and that forced people to modify the operating procedure, so you can't run it with all the valves closed, and forced a massive inspection of process in the nuclear industry, and they made it a lot better. So, as I say, it's the challenge of going for first of a kind to make that economic, or something that you know how to do and can make it cheaper incrementally, and American, obviously, took the latter course. And most of the new reactors that people are building are incremental designs on that basic prototype. To switch to a different sort of technology requires a much larger investment in terms of time and dollar resources. And at the moment, you know, the economics of it wouldn't do it. You can dig up coal and burn it cheaper. That's the argument.
A slight change, but an extension of what you're talking about, is if you're going to persuade a population that's essentially not convinced that nuclear power is the way that we might have to go, where are the advances in things like use of thorium likely to take us?
Thorium's no different. If you can't convince somebody to build one of these reactors, you're not going to convince them to build a thorium reactor.
But is it going to give rise potentially to a potentially safer reactor?
Well, there are designs for potentially safer reactors. I don't think it'll make any difference. I don't think the public is going to be able to differentiate between a thorium reactor, which is a different cycle, has advantages because there's more fuel potentially available, but has disadvantages in that it involves a reprocessing cycle as an inherent part of the system. So somebody who's anxious about nuclear is going to be anxious about it, whether it's a pebble bed reactor that you can just have lose all coolant and just leave sitting there and won't melt down, or a thorium reactor, or an ordinary sort of pressurized boiling water reactor. It doesn't make any difference. The nuance there is a technical nuance. It doesn't get at the deep way people are thinking about having nuclear or not, so I don't think it's going to make any difference. Now, an interesting one to think about is whether, if in 20, 30, 40 years' time, we can demonstrate that a fission reactor can work, whether that can make a substantial difference. And I'd be even sceptical about whether that's the case, because that's still also involving radioactive materials. It's just a shorter half-life, so the waste problem is less significant. But it will be interesting to see how that conversation develops over the next 20 years, because it will be 20 years before the technological challenge of a fusion power can be overcome. You know, an interesting contrast between fusion power and fission power is that it took only 3 years to get from understanding the physics of what was happening to building a reactor, whereas it's taken at least 30, 40 odd years from the speculation about the physics of the fusion process to having anything like a full-scale model of it. And that's being built at the moment, but it's been a long, long gestation period.
As safe as the sun.
Well, that's true, but the problem is the radiation from that comes in so dilute upon the planet. Concentrating it is a real struggle, and actually our society works at the moment on the back of concentrated energy. And you might have all these dreams that we can take a dilute source of energy and use it, but unless you can concentrate it effectively, the way we've organized society today has to change, and that's the challenge.